You may be seated. On behalf of the university, I welcome you to our opening convocation. Classes have begun, practices and games have been underway. But with this convocation, we mark more formally the beginning of the year. For the journey you are on, the journey we are on together, is worthy of this kind of an event. In the spirit of the success commitment signed by you and by President Bullock, in this service we dedicate ourselves to one another and to the work that lies ahead. It is right to be thankful and to have grateful hearts, to recognize every good gift in our lives that we do not deserve. In my tradition, we give thanks to God, recognizing that ultimately every good gift comes from God. Now, if you look around, there is a lot to be grateful for. There are many gifts and talents represented and gathered in this place, and we are grateful for you. With thankful hearts, I would ask now that you would join me in the call to worship, which is found in your bulletin, your program, and respond as indicated after me. Join now in the call to worship. Cry out with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with singing. For the Lord is a gracious God, whose mercy is everlasting, and whose faithfulness endures to all generations. I invite you to stand once again. And in the hope that you may recognize there's a purpose for your life, may we seek to sing together, to worship the God who made us, following along as our worship team leads us now.
Again. Please be seated. Let us pray. O merciful Father, grateful are we to be in this place, the University of Dubuque, called together to serve you. May the students be affirmed in their choice to bring their talents, their desire to learn, and their courage to embrace new opportunities with open hearts and minds. May the faculty and staff of UD uphold the mission of being a hospitable community of learning by sharing their wisdom and passion, and do so with compassion inspired by your Holy Spirit. Help us receive your grace so that we may encourage and support each other. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, amen. I now invite you to listen carefully to the choir as they sing Many Gifts, One Spirit.
Our scripture today will be from Psalms chapter 8, verses 1 through 9. I invite you all to celebrate our loving God through his word. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens, out of the mouths of babes and infants. You have founded a bulwark because of your foes, to silence the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of them, mortals that you care for them? Yet you have made them a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You have given them dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under their feet. all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The word of the Lord.
It is my pleasure to introduce our speaker today. Kathy Haug is the Regional Ministry Director for InterVarsity Christian Fellowship. InterVarsity is the U.S.'s branch of an international ministry organization that seeks to serve college students in over 170 countries around the world. Kathy has a passion to see lives transformed, to see leaders developed, and to see campuses renewed. She has spoken on numerous college campuses around the central region in the Midwest and has also spoken on the national level for InterVarsity. Kathy lives in Pella, Iowa with her husband and three children. And you will notice that she's very tall and often mistaken for a former collegiate athlete. But instead of focusing on athletics, Kathy focused on music during her time at the University of Northwestern. Please give a warm welcome to Kathy Haug.
When I walked on campus as an almost 18-year-old, I remember being filled with this swirl of paradoxical thoughts and emotions. At the one hand, I felt like this is big. It was a momentous occasion. I was proud to be a college student, and the moment was worth celebrating. At the same time, I also felt incredibly small. All of a sudden, I was swept up in this stream of talented, bright, and achieving people among whom I wondered if I would find my place. I thought, hey, I can completely reinvent myself. I could start over and be whomever I wanted to be. And at the same time, I thought I could never quite get away from who I'd been, my story, the journey I'd walked, and who people knew or thought me to be. I was both free from and weighed down by the expectations that I sensed others had of me or that I had of myself. I was energized. And I was exhausted, and classes hadn't even started yet. But I knew one thing. I knew it clearly and consistently deep in my soul. I knew that I wanted my life to matter. And not in some down the road, after graduation, future unknown kind of a way, but right now. And I had a sense of the profound potential of that moment in life. They say that in a seed is the potential for an entire forest. Or think of an apple, right? In an apple is a seed from which a tree can grow, and in that tree, the fruit with seeds to grow an entire orchard. And in that swirl of paradoxical thoughts and feelings that seemed to cry out of such potential, I didn't quite know for sure which of those things were meant to be put in the ground simply to be buried. Really, to be grieved and left for good? And which of those things were really more like seeds, rather, to be planted, to be cultivated and nurtured that something new might arise? I remember my sister coming home after the first semester of her freshman year. She was just 1 year ahead of me in college. And she came home and told us the story about how she and her freshman roommate had had this very elaborate, very somber ceremony where they buried their 4.0s. And so they told us of this because they had realized that that grade point average that meant so much, that was so intertwined with their sense of self and value as high schoolers, after just a few weeks in organic chemistry as bio majors, they realized that was out of reach for them. And I say this, and I'm sure your distinguished faculty and staff on stage would be quick to join me in saying, don't bury the dream of academic achievement so quickly. That's not it. But to the degree to which that has been unhelpfully interwoven with your sense of self or identity, perhaps there's an invitation to let that go and instead plant in the ground those dreams, that some new way of engaging with curiosity and delight and wonder in the field to which you're applying your vocational learning, might that new reality spring up? So as I felt all those things and wrestled with those questions, I didn't know where that dream of a life that would matter particularly came from at first, but by the end of my freshman year, I would find out. And I would learn something by the end of first year that would forever change the way I saw myself, understood myself, and the way I would be invited to actually see and understand every human being whose path I might cross. And that was this. Imago Dei. It means image of God. For you see, at the new beginning of the universe, we learn that God said, "Let us make humankind in our image. Let us, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, make humans in our likeness." Imago Dei, this mystery that somehow that you are made in the image of triune God, like God to create and to dream and to advocate and connect and reconcile. All of a sudden, you realize your value is not in that exam grade. It's not in your latest game stats or your published works, your injury status, or capturing that prestigious internship, but rather it transcends those things because Imago Dei. You are made in the image of Creator with the potential to be upright and unleashed for good in this world. One of my favorite Imago Dei stories is actually from one of the biographies of Jesus, and in the Christian tradition we might call that the Gospel of Luke. So Luke was an author who captured all of these eyewitness accounts and stories of the life of Jesus, and they're in this biography. And there's one wonderful story in there about a woman who gets a new beginning. And in this story, it took place in a setting maybe not so unlike this one. It was a gathering for worship and learning and teaching. It was a holy day in their holy place, the synagogue, but not so unlike this. And Jesus was up teaching and communicating, and all of a sudden the story grinds to a halt when it says he sees a woman. And we don't know a lot from the author about this woman, but we do know a few things. We know, first of all, that this woman had been afflicted for a very long time. And in fact, the story tells us that she'd been afflicted by a spirit for 18 long years. And the text also tells us that this woman was bent over, and she couldn't straighten up at all. But as the story unfolds, Jesus sees her. And not in that kind of taking in the audience, just noting and observing something about her, but in the sense that she was known. And he sees her, and then he calls her forward to be seen and known in her community. And as she comes forward, he says to her, "Woman, you're set free from your infirmity." And he places his hands on her. And it says that immediately she straightens up and she praises God. I've spoken and met a lot of college students who come to campuses every year like this, like you. And I meet a lot of students who come in pretty bent over from the 18 years they've lived before they get to campus. And I don't know how you come into this new year or this place, but if you come in a little, maybe a lot bent over from the experiences you've had and the life you've lived, I want you to hear and know today that you, first and foremost, are seen. And not in a scan the universe, notice a few things kind of a way, but in a way in which you are known. And you're called forward to be seen and known in the community of the University of Dubuque. And it's my deep hope that here you will be set free to be upright in this place. For as image bearers, we are all invited to be upright before the one whose image we bear and in the community of our fellow image bearers. Which brings us to the second imperative that this mystery reveals, and that is that we are to work to see and honor Imago Dei in the lives of others as well. And let's face it, this is not always easy, right? Some of you know, maybe the honeymoon period with your roommate is already over, right? Or that resident or someone down the hall in the first day, their quirks and idiosyncrasies, or our quirks and idiosyncrasies, were maybe endearing, but not so much anymore. Maybe you've had a professor or a student who's already challenging your thinking and your worldview and making you a bit uncomfortable, or a coach or a teammate who's pushing you a little further than you think you can or want to go. And that's to say nothing of the real and deep pain that we encounter as we come into contact with the brokenness, the fruit of prejudice, of racism and misogyny, of homophobia and xenophobia, and all of those things rise up and challenge us to say, how can we still work to see and honor Imago Dei in others this year? This spring, my family got together and we remembered and celebrated the life of my youngest brother, Terrence Andrew Paul. Andy, that's how we knew him. He had lived all but the first 3 weeks of his 25 years of life in a body that bore the scars of trauma, brain trauma, inflicted at the hands of his biological father when he was just an infant. And so Andy's whole life, every basic human need had to be met by others. And as his adoptive sister, had a lot of conversations over the years and wrestled in my own heart and mind too with questions about the quality of Andy's life, the purpose, the meaning, the contribution of his life. And as we gathered at the memorial service, I was struck as people shared stories and recalled how many of the people who had had the gift and grace of their lives intersecting with Andy's, they would recount the ways that his life challenged them to a fresh sense of gratitude. Challenged them to not take for granted simple gifts like the breeze on your face, a human touch, a sound, a scent. Andy's life was a simple yet stunning embodiment of Imago Dei. Sometimes we have to work to see it and honor it. And as we strive to honor Imago Dei in ourselves and in others, sometimes we come up against some voices of resistance. And they come at times from unlikely places. Sometimes it's from right here, isn't it? It's the voice that says, you're not smart enough. You're not articulate enough, strong enough, fill in the blank enough. And sometimes the voice of resistance comes from the people we think should most be for us, for our living into our full potential. And in that Imago Dei story of the woman with the new beginning I told, we see the same thing, that the moment that she is upright and set free, it says people in the room were indignant. They said, oh, no, 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 this isn't the time for that kind of thing. They said, this isn't the place. Not here, not now, not her. And I love it, Jesus puts them in their place and calls out their hypocrisy. He says, you know, if you had livestock that needed a drink of water, you would take them out to get what they needed. But this woman, this daughter of Abraham, you would let her stay one more day bound? And when he affirms her freedom in the community and names her a daughter of Abraham, he doesn't only confirm that she belongs, is part of the family and the community, but reaffirms her very purpose and empowers her potential. Because she now is reminded that she's caught up in the very purposes of God to be a blessing to the nations. So when those voices say, maybe not now, just now's the time to keep your nose down, to focus on what's right in front of you, and to not dream too big or think too lofty, we know that those who choose and work to see Imago Dei in themselves and others are created to dream and advocate and connect and reconcile, and you are empowered for great good. The purpose and potential is unleashed. And it's clear after the story of this woman wraps up, and we hear two short parables about what this new reality of upright and unleashed peoples could look like. And Jesus says it's like the smallest seed that could grow into an enormous tree that could give refuge and shelter to living things. Or it's like yeast, the tiniest speck of yeast, but when you work it through that dough, it will rise to feed neighbors and nations. Remember that many of the world's most notable social and spiritual change movements had their epicenter in the university world. They had their genesis in the hearts and minds of staff and faculty and students. And as image bearers, upright and unleashed for good, the seeds of potential have been planted. What subversively small dream, advocacy, connection, reconciliation might find its genesis in the heart and minds of a campus community that might change the world this year? Why not the University of Dubuque? Why not the class of 2023? Why not you? Thank you.
I invite you to stand. As a response to the goodness of who God is and who we have been called. I'd invite you to sing with us.
Thank you. You may be seated. Believe it or not, someone was supposed to come and introduce me and also say that I too am 6 feet five. So I'm not sure we're supposed to do that, but let's make that happen next time. On behalf of the larger community of Dubuque, I do want to, again, welcome each and every single one of you. In order to welcome each and every single one of you, I want you guys to do me a favor. We're going to try to put some energy in the room. So if I call you out, I want you to stand up and every single body in the room, just clap and let's celebrate them. So if you are a teacher, a faculty, an administrator, or a coach, can you please stand up so we can thank you for all that you do? Yes. Thank you. You may be seated. If this is your first year on campus, can you please stand up so we can welcome you? Thank you. If this is your second year on campus, can you please stand up so we can welcome you? Thank you. If this is your third year on campus, can you please stand up so we can welcome you? And if this is your last year on campus, can you please stand up? We welcome you. We welcome each and every single one of you on the campus. There was a quote before I got here that really came to mind that I really wanted to share with each and every single one of you. The quote is, "The future belongs to those who prepare for it today." Let me say that again. The future belongs to those who prepare for it today. I want to ask you a question. For those of you who have 1, 2, 3, or 4 more years left, what are you doing today to prepare for you tomorrow? What are you doing today? While you have the time that you have on campus, I want to strongly encourage each and every single one of you to be great and to do great things, to understand that each and every single one of you, when you were created from birth, that there was greatness inside of you, and that greatness inside of you is not just for yourself, but also to serve others. Just take a look at our military family over there. Can we give them a round of applause? Thank you. Thank you for your sacrifice and what you plan to do for others. While you're here, I want to challenge you. What are you doing to use your greatness for others? How will you be a part of the UD tradition and history? History like the volleyball team from last year who was kicking butt. Is our volleyball team here?
Here we are.
Here we are. Where are they at? Yeah, we want to celebrate you guys. Continue to kick butt. Their tradition, be a part of tradition like our women's basketball team, our men's basketball team, our men's football team, or the basketball team, the wrestling team, all of the sports. Be part of the tradition here that's constantly kicking butt. Can we give all of you a round of applause? And if you're not in sports, here's something that I want you to do. Be engaged. Get involved, not only on campus here, but also in the larger community. Because each and every single one of you, there's something inside of you that's going to make the world a better place. Again, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today. And I pray, and my prayer is that whatever that I can do as a member of the larger community to bring that greatness inside of each and every single one of you, I extend my hand and my offer, and I'm pretty sure these amazing staff behind me and that are sitting next to you, they will do the same. Again, thank you and welcome to the larger community, and that is my prayer that you will realize the greatness inside of you and use it to build this community. Thank you.
I'm not nearly as energetic as Anderson. So please, stand up. As we close with the benediction and then the choral benediction, what I'd invite you to do, if you're comfortable as a community, as a community of learning, as a community of faith, as a community of encouragement, I invite you, as so long as you're comfortable, to put your arms on each other's shoulders. All right, I invite you to receive, together to receive this benediction. And now go in peace and serve the Lord, and may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and abide within you, each one, now and forevermore. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.